All right, next article I'm going to talk about here. New law, women can sue men for getting them pregnant. This law is kind of a weird one. And it's in response to Texas coming up with their heartbeat bill, which says anyone beyond 6 weeks cannot delete their unborn. And this is just a way of getting back at them. But the weird thing is it's from a different state. So we have this weird thing happening now where a state, someone in New York City or someone in California says, I don't like the laws here. I don't like California's laws. I don't like New York's laws. What are they told to do? Well, they're told to get out, move to a different state then. But what happens when you're in Texas or one of these other states and people say, well, I don't like the laws here. You don't get to, you don't get to tell them to leave. No, they demand that we change the laws in this state to suit everyone throughout the United States. And so this is a representative. I don't want to get in the politics of this, but there is a little bit of politics here. This is from Representative Chris Rabb. He says, proud dad, a rabble rouser, public servant representing the people of Northwest Philly in Pennsylvania's 200th legislation district and all Pennsylvanians, he/him. And so this is what he's putting forward. Now, I have to assume this is getting even with the bill that was passed in Texas. I have to assume it was. But it goes a little bit beyond. It goes a little bit beyond forcing men to not only get sued, but they're now talking about actually forcing surgery on them. It says, I will be introducing a bill inspired by Rep. Kelly Cassidy that requires all inseminators to undergo vasectomies within 6 weeks of having their third child or 40th birthday, whichever comes first. So now we're not men anymore. I guess officially we're inseminators because men can be women and women can be men. He says, additionally, my forthcoming bill would codify the definition of wrongful conception to include when a person has demonstrated negligence toward preventing conception during intercourse. And let me zoom this up a bit so you can see it better. This legislation will allow Pennsylvanians to take civil action against inseminators for unwanted pregnancy who wrongfully conceive a child with them. Last, this bill would empower Pennsylvanians to enforce this prospective law by offering a $10,000 reward for reporting the proper authorities, those scofflaws, who have not complied with this statute within the allotted time frame. As long as legislators continue to restrict the reproductive rights of cis women, trans men, and non-binary folks, there should be laws to address the responsibility of men who impregnate them. So here's the thing. Women can choose or not to choose to get pregnant. Women can choose or not to choose to delete their baby if they so wish, with the exception of Texas after 6 weeks. But then they can just drive to a different state and get it done. But that aside, what he's saying is that if you have had a third kid, or your 40th birthday, whichever comes first, we're going to force sterilization on men. That's what really this boils down to. Now, let's just pause this. And if we want to know if this is okay, let's always do what I say and reverse the genders. Any woman that has had three children or has hit her 35th or 40th birthday must be sterilized, period. Or you can sue them and take them to court for civil action. Is this okay? I'm pretty sure if you were talking about sterilizing women, there would be a freak out. So why is it okay to push this law on men? Now, granted, I am over the age of 40, and yes, I have had a vasectomy, and I think it was the smartest decision I ever made. I did it when I was around 35. If I were smart and I was a young man today, I'd get it done when I was 21 or as soon as I could find a urologist that would do it for me. But now they're literally just talking about doing this to men after their third kid. What if you're Mormon? What if you're just a very successful man? Here's the bill. This is House co-sponsoring memoranda from the Pennsylvania House of Representatives. October 2nd, 2021. Far too long, the public debate around child deletion, contraception, and related reproductive matters have thrust government into the center of restrictive bodily autonomy of women and girls. Rarely is there a meaningful dialogue around public policy focusing on the personal responsibility of cisgender men in this sphere. The rights of cisgender men have always been paramount in our society, with little focus on their responsibility as inseminators to change their behaviors for the good of their partners, families, and societies at large. Actually, that's incorrect. It's called child support. Now, granted, I think men should make sure that they are a part of any child's life that they help create. However, many times they're not allowed to because the women decide to take child support over allowing that man to be in the child's life. And we know this because there are courts and there are lawyers that specifically state, here are ways that you can blame him for being harmful or bad to you and your kids so that you will win full custody, so you will win more money. That's a thing. So men are already paying financially. Again, women can decide to keep it. Women can decide not to keep it. Men cannot decide to pay or not to pay. Men always will pay. And now, not only will they pay, so if a woman says, I didn't want this, but she keeps it to term, not only can she get child support, but now she can actually sue him for getting her pregnant and win more money for that. Do you see where we might have some problems with this? Gentlemen, I tell you now, you best be really careful if things like this continue to get pushed, because they may pass somewhere and you might not know it until not only do you get hit with a child support notice, but you may get hit with the inability to see your own kid that you might want to be a father to, and you might be sued on top of that. They say, as we head towards climax on this heated discourse around this delicate matter, we should come together to address it with surgical precision. Very funny. We must also commit to mending the social fabric being sliced up by bitter acrimony. In order to improve public health outcomes and release sweet justice into our households and bedrooms, we must wrap our love of individual liberty in the moral imperative of greater personal responsibility and acknowledge men's essential role in procreation. Is it me, or is he not really being creepy with all the innuendos in here? He says, therefore, I will be introducing legislation that will require all inseminators to undergo vasectomies within 6 weeks from having their third child or their 40th birthday, whichever comes first. Further, this legislation will allow Pennsylvanians to take civil action for unwanted pregnancies against inseminators who wrongfully conceive a child with them. This legislation will also empower Pennsylvanians to enforce this new law by offering a $10,000 reward for reporting to the property authorities those scufflaws who have not complied with the statute within the allocated time frame. As long as state legislators continue to restrict the reproductive rights of cis women, trans men, and non-binary people, there should be laws that address the responsibility of men who impregnate them. Thus, my bill will also codify wrongful conception to include when a woman has when a person has demonstrated negligence towards preventing conception during intercourse. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. In the spirit of this popular axiom, I encourage my colleagues to take a gander at this forthcoming bill that seeks to end this egregiously gendered double standard for the benefit of all individuals, our families, and our great commonwealth. This guy is a joke. This is a joke bill. Now, do I think it'll actually pass? No. But the point is, just to try to make a point and own the Texans for making a law that he doesn't like, he's putting forth basically, let's sterilize men. Part of the big problem I have with this is men have really three options. One, vasectomy. Two, prophylactic. Three, the pull out and pray and spray method, the withdrawal method. That's it. Men have three. Women have all the things. They have all the choices. And when they lie and they say, I'm on something or I've taken this, and they trap a guy, now they're talking about coming around and trapping him again. But look at this though, right? I have this chart here from the FDA. Sterilization surgery for women and for men. It's a one-time permanent procedure, okay? We're going to take this off the table because we know that's an option. So that's an even, that's a draw. Women have an IUD, which is out of copper. Less than 1% chance of getting impregnated. IUD with progestin, less than 1% chance of getting impregnated. Implantable rod, less than 1% chance. A shot or injection, less than 6% chance. Oral contraceptives, less than 9% chance. Oral contraceptives with extended continuous use combined pill, less than 9% chance. Oral contraceptives, the mini pill, progestin only, 9% chance. The patch, 9% chance. Vaginal contraceptive ring, 9% chance. Diaphragm with spermicide, 12% chance. Sponge with spermicide, 12 to 24% chance. Cervical cap with spermicide, 17 to 23% chance. The male prophylactic, 18% chance. So there's the guy's first one out of all this list. Here's the first one for men that men can put on and be responsible for. Because all these others she can lie about, or she can say, I forgot, or she can say she's taking and you don't know. All these other ones are like, oh no, I have a sponge in, or I have a cap in, or you don't know. So but again, a dozen of them. The female prophylactic, okay? That's one that a guy could make a woman use. So there's maybe two that he would definitely know something's being used. Spermicide alone, and then two various forms of the morning after. And then if it does happen, women do have the chance of deleting it as well. Women have all the choices. And then when to blame it on the guy because he finished, and she's like, well, I didn't want this. You literally have 20 opportunities or different ways to protect yourselves. And what happens if it circumvents some of these and she does happen to get pregnant? She can get rid of it, or she can keep it and he has to pay child support for the next 18 years. Or best of all, you both decide, oops, this was bad, but you know something, we're bringing a life into the world. Let's do the right thing and raise it well and treat it well. And let it learn and be the best little human being it can be, or put it up for adoption. A lot of people don't know this, but I'm adopted. My mother couldn't have children. She had to have a hysterectomy by her late 20s or early 30s, I think. She just couldn't have kids. I am adopted. My father is adopted by his parents going back to when was he born? 1943. Sometime around there. He was adopted by his parents. His mother or father, one of them, couldn't have kids. So he was unwanted by someone and he was put up for adoption. My dad turned out to be a great man. I turned out to be, well, I'm me. I think I'm doing okay. There's other options out there. But now to just say, hey, you know what? I'm going to put forth a bill to sterilize men when 6 weeks from their 40th birthday or their third kid. We're doing something wrong. When we're writing legislation to just punish somebody because a different state made a law that you disagree with, so now you're going to write a ridiculous law? If you don't like the law in Texas, move out of Texas. Pick a different state. If you don't like a law in New York, and if you don't like this law in Pennsylvania, and it does pass, move to a different state. But then would it be right if Virginia then came out to write a law that would punish people because of the law in Pennsylvania, which was written to punish people because of the law in Texas? We got to have some commonality somewhere.